Hi, welcome to Euler's game Hypergrid, an ultimate action-driven game of sandbox tactics. This is a game for two players from 7 years old and up, which takes exactly 16 turns per player, which is around 30 to 60 minutes for game session. What you're trying to do is you're trying to place two tokens on a turn, create combos for their effects, and create more lines than your opponent. What you get is a fantastic production. This is a neoprene player mat. These are nice and chunky plastic tokens, the elements. We have five elements in the game, and each player starts with six of each of the colors. So you have the white player and the black player. Each player is sitting opposite to the other. So let's say this is the black player and this is the white player. And the game setup is as follows. So what you do is you set the map, the table board at the game table in the center, and then you get to choose one side and take six colors of each of the elements and create a stack. These elements are the red fire burns, the green earth snakes, the yellow arrow air blows, the blue water wheels, and the purple aether transforms. Each player has this nice player aid that you have next to you, so you can remember the special abilities for each element, and have placed on the left one for you guys to always see, but it's also one included in the rulebook, so it's easy to remember the abilities of each element. So as we said, each player is starting with their reserve. One player has six tokens of each of the five elements on their side. Then we have the nether score locks, which is here. It is one more spare per element, which you place in the reverse side, indicating just the color, and you place this nether score transluent block here, because it's going to show which color is blocked each turn by placing it on top of that specific color. And the next thing you do is you have the nether score locks, which are these very nice chunky colored dice, you can say. You just indicate with the color what you want to indicate, but in any case they look amazing. And you have them on this side. This is a common pile of ready to use line locking markers. You have eight. You have one more in the game, which is for a future use, I suppose, some kind of expansion which is on the works for this game. So red fire burns, yellow air blows, blue water wheels, green earth snakes, purple ether transforms. Five colors match five elements with their powers. You have to master them all and beware of the anti-element nether. The nether blocking track, it's one element token of each color, which is on the top, and it's indicating, serves as a matching discard pile for the burn tokens. We'll see later from the abilities what that means. And the nether element block, the transparent marker, is, as mentioned, used to indicate which color is blocked each time. So just a bit of the concepts of the game. This is an abstract game with pattern recognition, tile placement, and nice cool elements in it. So it's very, very interesting. But one of the some of the basic terms that we need to familiarize ourselves with are the grids and the goals. So the grid, you can see that this is a 3x3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, a 3x3, 9 possible positions to place your elements. So you can place them on the various slots like that, and on top of other elements. We'll see how this works once we explain the game. This is coming from your reserve, so you need to carefully think how to use them. But this is a 3x3, as I mentioned, grid, and the tokens are piled in pilers, which are called common for each. So once placed, an element on the game board does not belong to any player, so it's part of the game board, so the opponent can place on top of that, for example. And then you have different, it's up to you and your strategy. I'm going to explain what you're trying to do. So for example, this is a pile. When you have a stack of different elements, even if a single one, this is considered to be a pile. Otherwise you have empty spaces on the game board. So what do we mean by empty spot? Is just whatever you don't have anything colorful and it's a blank slot. What do we mean by a new line? We have three tokens of the same color. When they become visible by any means, they form a straight line on the grid, and this is going to give you points. There are eight unique scoring possibilities on the grid. So for example, you can have this yellow line, this yellow line, or this yellow line. There are various ways to create lines, obviously, in a 3x3 grid, but in any case, this you have to observe from the top and see only the top revealed color for each element. A few things to note is that a single pillar, an element, for example, can score for two or even more unique lines at the same time, as we have seen. For example, this can score for this one, for that one, or for this one as well, which means essentially that an element token placed on the corner of the grid position can be part of three different lines at a time, a mid-edge pillar of the grid can be scoring for two lines, and an element placed onto the central position, for example, this one here, can score up to four lines. And this one, the diagonal as well. Each line ends with two outer spaces surrounding the grid, and the circle spaces helps to keep the track of the score and host the Nether lock during the game. So you see, around the 3x3 we have a score track. You start with these nice colored dice that they have numbers from the blank side, and they start moving clockwise. So as you score points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and then when you go to 16, you have to switch your die to indicate 1. And then you continue moving around, so you mark your score track, and the same happens with the opponent marker. Also, this is a place where you put the different Nether blocks when they occupy different lines, and you see which line is blocked. We're going to explain how this is done. But also it accommodates the score track around the game board. So let's see how the game flows. You choose a starting player that will use the white score point tracker, and the other one gets a black one. Players take turns, and on their turn, each player places two element tokens from their own reserve onto the grid, and eventually score user powers, if they can, in order to create as many new lines as possible, each giving one victory point, and you are adding the points by marking them on the score track, trying also to prevent the opponent from creating lines on the following turn. So you're using also some defensive mechanisms as well. Once a token is placed onto the grid, it becomes free for all to manipulate later during the turn. The victor of the duel is the player who has the most victory points at the end of the game, and the game ends at the start of the turn of any player on which the player has no tokens, no elements, that is, in the reserve to place onto the grid, in accordance to the rules. No unblocked element. So let's see the player's turn. Only on the very first turn of the game, the starting player, which is the white player, say the player on the left, as we said, with a white marker, they place one element token, any element from their own reserve that they can use anywhere on the grid, and then they block that element as a result. So for example, he's selecting this element, say he's placing it here, and then he indicates with this block that this color is blocked. Keep in mind that when you place another block on the respective color, you indicate that this color cannot be used at the next turn. And then the next, this is done only at the beginning, I mean the single token placement, and then it's the next player's normal turn. So the second and any following turn of the game, the player may perform any of the following actions. You have three possibilities, which indicate what you can do. The player may perform any of the following actions during their turn and multiple times, but keep in mind that the first action, which is place one of the tokens, must be always performed twice. That means that you always have to perform two elements, which is two tokens, on your turn on the game board. So the first thing you can do, obviously, as I already mentioned, is place one token of any unblocked element from your own reserve onto any spot on the grid. Or if there is already a pillar, you can place it on the pillar, and the placed token goes on top of the other tokens, and then that becomes the visible color. There are no restrictions on the token placement. As long as it is on the top a level of any pillar, a player has always all nine grid positions to his options where he can place the colored element. But this has to be an unblocked color element. The height of the pillar has no limit, so you can stack as many elements as you want on top of each other. The element, the color essentially, that the player just placed is now blocked, and the element previously blocked becomes unblocked. You relocate immediately the nether block onto the respective color, and you indicate the new color which is locked. Always remember the golden rule that the same element color can never be placed subsequently twice in a row, regardless of a change of the player's turn. Meaning, if for example I decide to play red, then I cannot play red again. Say I can play another color green, and then I indicate that I block green. Then it's the next player's turn, the black player. He cannot play green because it's still locked from the previous player turn. So that means that he can play red because now it's unlocked, for example here, and then indicate that red is locked. And then he has to play another color, but again himself cannot play, a red. He can play, for example, a yellow and indicate which color is blocked. The second thing B, it is that the fact that if a token is placed from a player's reserve onto a stack of two or more tokens, regardless of the color of the tokens it's placed onto, then the active player may activate the effect of the placed element. This is not mandatory, you can choose not to activate if you want. We're gonna come back with the effects of the elements, which is the juice of the game and makes it very, very interesting. But as an important rule, always keep in mind that only the third or higher token can reactivate an element. Meaning that if I play, for example, now, green, I block green, I cannot activate the ability of green. On the subsequent turn, I can place yellow even on top of that. Again, I cannot activate the ability of yellow because it's two levels high. And then I indicate block. I lock yellow. Then it's an extra player's turn. And then, for example, say he wants to play red. And obvious here would be here to score 1 point. But anyway, now if he plays as a third or higher token the red, he can activate the effect of the red element because it's three and higher levels up. And then you apply the applicable effect of that element in its reach, which you're going to come back and say what is reach of the effect. Then the last thing is C, is you gain one victory point for each newly created straight line of three visible elements of the same kind, meaning the same color, at any time during the turn, and then you lock the newly created line. So for example, say with the second I didn't play now red, say I played something different, I played blue. And then it's this player's turn, then he's going to play his second element, he's going to play red. He is creating a line of three connected elements of the same color anywhere on the board, on the different levels or whatever, diagonally, orthogonally, or horizontally or vertically, in any case. So he can create one, he scores one victory point. If for some reason he was placing his element here, he would create two lines of the same color simultaneously, and he would get two victory points for those, or even within his first turn or his second turn, depending on the effects that he would create. But in any case, now he has placed his token here, he scores one victory point during his turn, and then he must indicate that this line is locked. So what he does is he's taking one of these nice, beautiful looking cubes, the nether blocks, and then he has to place it either here or here at any point of the end of the lines that he created to indicate that this line is now locked. And you place it with the red facing up to remember that this is a line just created, scored, and gives one victory point for him. That being said, immediately you understand that the line must be unlocked for a given color in order to gain a victory point. So you cannot, for example, use a line that is already locked to put here two red for some reason, or have one already here and put here, and then to use the third one from here to create your new three connected red ones to get a victory point. So the line must be unlocked. So for scoring, important, when scoring happens, you take consideration each time a line of three matching elements, which is created at any time during the player's turn, after token placement, during an element effect. This is important for the air element, which, for example, we'll see what it does later on, and after the execution of the effect. Line locking is immediately happening after scoring, and an ether lock die must be placed face up with the color of the scoring element in order to lock the newly created elementic line. The nether lock can be placed on any of the two ends of the locked line in the outer space grid, preferably out of the way of the scoring tracking moving clockwise, meaning that if for some reason you had your scoring tracking here because you had that many points, you're just gonna put it here to indicate that this line is locked. It doesn't matter because you don't have to put it here to confuse it with the scoring marker. In any case, wherever you put it, this line is locked, and this is indicated by this block being placed there. So coming back to our example, this guy would have created one line of three connected elements and he would score 1 point. So he is the white player. He would take his marker from the starting section and move it one to indicate that now he has one victory point. And again, as mentioned before, lock the line here. So it cannot be used for scoring purposes immediately. And the next logical question to ask is when line unlocking occurs. So when line unlocking happens, after token placement or after the elemental effect execution, at any time later or on during their game, the nether lock score must be immediately removed from the locked line. If the last one of the element tokens on that line matches the color of the nether lock. For example, the two other pillars are gone or changed their visible colors. So in practical words, what you do is during the turn, this lock cannot be removed until two of the three elements of this line are not red anymore. Meaning if in the future turns this and that happens, then you only have one red in this line, which means that this lock is removed from this line and it can be used again. It is very important to pay attention when unlocking a line after each token placement and after elemental effects, but not during the effect itself. More experienced players will be closely watching to remove locks than newcomers to help them with this effect. So the juice of the games, the game is the elements and the effects of the elements, which is a very nice addition on top of the abstract core of this game, which looks cool, awesome with the new, the fantastic components. So we need to understand what elemental effects do, but before we do that, because most elemental effects refer to the term reach, we need to understand what reach applies to. So for example, this has to do on the special area effect that covers the range where the effect of the element occurs. Remember the golden rule, for an effect to be activated, needs to be at least three or higher on a stack. Otherwise, if it's just the second, for example, if I was placing this one, then I cannot activate the effect of the newly placed element. Say for the example of the benefit of the video that now we're just explaining the effects of the third and higher level, so we can activate the effects of the elements. So just to show you the reach, where is the special area, the range where the effect occurs on the game board. So the reach can have either the element can be placed on the corner grid. For example, let's say that this player places this here, okay, this is matching also, it's the third on the stack, now it's blocked, and this is where the red element has been placed, on a corner. When the element is placed on the corner of the grid, the position has four pillars within reach. Remember, a pillar must have at least one, so if this was not a pillar, then you don't have this within reach. But now we place the element here, so the reach of this element is 1, 2, 3, and 4 for itself. The same would happen if it goes on this corner. 1, 2, 3, 4. Or that. So all the corners provide a reach of 4 for all the 4 spaces of the pillars. The mid edge of the grid has 6 pillars in reach, so if you place this one here, and then say you place again this one here, now it is on the third level, you can activate this one. This element has 6 positions, 6 pillars in reach. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 for itself. And the last possible position is when the element is placed exactly onto the central position of the game board, and then you have the whole grid in the area of the effect. So for example, this player is placing purple here, and then he's placing, for example, red here. Now this is a third again. You can activate the effect, and the reach of this effect is all the game board, because it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and itself 9 positions of the grid. Okay, so now I'm going to finish this video by explaining the list of powers which you have on this side, where you can always have a player aid for each player, so you can remember the effects, which is very important. But quickly, let's see the powers themselves. So I'm going positioning every time the element here, it's at least 3 levels high. So again, every time it's going to be activated. So for explaining the purposes of the effects, well, they're going to go here and I'm going to tell you what they do. So let's say I'm playing a red element here. I can activate the effect of this red element. This is the red fire burns, and it burns any one element token on the grid that is within reach of the fire token just placed. So I can burn any, the reach of this one are all the game board, all the positions of the 9 grid, because we said it's in the center. So I can burn any of those tokens. For example, I could burn, say for this explanation, this was here. So I can burn this one, which means I can take this out, and then I immediately reveal a line like that and I score 1 victory point. And this is one of the effects of the burn. You remove the burn token from the play and place it onto the respective discard pile of the nether lock. So you take it out and you place it here. And then never on the player's reserve. And then the token of fire can burn itself, so you can burn also itself if you want, in the same way, because it's within reach. The next is the green earth snakes. So for example, say I place this stack here and I activate the green element, which is the green earth snakes, within reach of the earth token just placed here, relocate the bottom element token onto the top of its pillar, or flip that whole pillar upside down. For example, reverse the order of the element tokens. So what you're going to do is, this is another example, say this was like that. Okay, I place here, I activate my green effect. Within reach, I can either take the bottom and put it on top, or as it is, I can flip the whole pile like that. And then obviously I have created a line and I score 1 victory point. Then we have the yellow, which is yellow air blows. I don't have to put it on the center, obviously. I can put it wherever I want. I'm just putting it here because I have the maximum reach, so I can show you the effects easily. That's why you understand that the centerpiece is very, very important for strategic purposes, obviously. So what you do with the yellow air blows, you relocate any one element token from the grid onto any other pillar that is within reach of the position of the air token just placed. So for example, okay, so for purposes of this video, say I place it here, say this was here, and I place my yellow element here. I can relocate any, say this was here, okay, and I place my new element here. I can relocate any element within reach because the wind blows. So I can take it here, here, or here. And I can do that because if I was, say it was like that, so I can show you a scoring as well. So I activate this, I relocate any top element of that, and I put it in the within reach somewhere. So now I created another line and I score 1 more victory point. Then we have the blue water whales. Swap any 2 pillars on the grid, place one whole pillar instead of the other one, and vice versa. Tokens do not change their order within the swap pillars. Neither of the 2 pillars has to be within reach of the water token just placed, but its pillar can be one of the swapped pillars. So for example, let me show you an example of how the blue water wheels work. Okay, say for demonstration purposes, it was like that. Okay, so when placing this one, I can relocate 2 pillars like that, and I create another line and I score victory points again, 1 victory point. The last is the purple ether transforms. Take any one element token different from ether that is within reach of ether token just placed, and place it in your reserve. So for example, within reach of here. I can take any of those tokens. I take this one. This is the only way to gain elements back to your reserve, so you have more than your opponent in theory. So you can see the abilities of the elements are very powerful. You can do a lot of cool things with this when you use them at the correct time. So it's all about pattern recognition, you know, element placement, and understanding the crucial point when you need to act. Also, the effects of the elements are very, very cool because they give you very nice possibilities to open your strategy and play very, you know, strategize about what you do next on your next turn. It's a very nice back and forth between two players. It is very cool production, very thinky. It's like playing a very deeply thought abstract game with nice fantastic production and a lot of options to choose from. Very, very impressed by this game. I had absolutely no idea of this game. This is a pity. This is an example of how many cool new games come out and we never get to see them because they're not on the radar of a lot of people. I hope we managed to show you that this is a very nice option and something good to try if you're into abstract games. Hope you enjoyed this hard to play video. This is Hypergrid by Epitrapezume. Many thanks for watching.